Hey, welcome back. Jeff Nelson with VetShores here. Today I'm talking about nuts and Dr. Joel Furman. Now, let me say that I've known Dr. Furman for about 15 years. He has spoken at my events many times. We've always had a very cordial and friendly relationship. A couple of years ago when my wife was hit on her bike by a truck and nearly killed, Dr. Furman was one of the people who reached out and offered assistance. And I'm very grateful to Dr. Furman. I appreciated that concern a lot. Let me also say that I like Joel Furman. He's a smart guy. We've had some fun time together over the years, and we're both on the same side when it comes to promoting a plant-based diet. Okay, so as you know, I've been working on a video series on nuts and commercial research. If you haven't watched my series, please feel free to check it out. If you've watched these videos, you know that I've discussed Dr. Michael Greger at times and the research that he promotes. Most of the videos have thumbnails that show Dr. Greger, but I've never brought up Dr. Furman because these videos were not about him. However, Dr. Furman did decide that my video series is about him.
It's Jeff Nelson, and he's directing it at me.
I know that he was talking about Dr. Greger. I didn't realize it was directed specifically at you as well.
Why? Let's think about what his motivation is.
Dr. Furman wrote a response to some of the points I made in my nuts video series. Here is the article Dr. Furman wrote. In this video now, I'm going to go through Dr. Furman's article. I'm going to look at the studies he's pointing to, and I'm going to show where he is mistaken about what those studies say. I'd like to remind everybody at this point of what I say in all of these videos that I've done about nuts, and that is that I'm not advising anyone to stop eating nuts. I eat nuts. They're healthy. I am not anti-nut. It's funny how I have to keep repeating this. But my video series is about exposing the flawed research being used to claim that nuts have these incredible health benefits, like they protect against heart disease or they extend your life. That's extremely weak research and can be safely ignored. Nuts, eat them if you like them, but don't be scared into believing that you need to eat nuts or that they're some superfood. They're not. In his reaction to my nut video, Dr. Furman speculated on my motives in making this video series.
Let's think about what his motivation is, right? Why is he? Obviously, he's doing this because the evidence and the studies are showing otherwise than his favorite nutritional gurus are, than people he's representing, right, have said to do. It's making the research is making them look bad.
Dr. Furman takes this same opening tack in his article. He wrote, "It has been brought to my attention that a series of videos has been posted and promoted on YouTube attempting to discredit the studies documenting the lifespan extending properties of including nuts and seeds in one's diet. The individuals represented here want to try to protect their legacy of promoting an extremely low-fat vegan diet's nut and seed exclusion. Unfortunately, according to a preponderance of evidence, this outmoded and disproven stance does lead to premature death." According to Dr. Furman, I am protecting someone's legacy by making this video series on nuts. I can only speculate as to whom he believes I'm protecting. Dr. Esselstyn, maybe? Dr. Ornish? Dr. Bernard? McDougall? Pritikin? Matthew Letterman? Or Alona Pold from Forks Over Knives? I actually have no idea who he's talking about here. Dr. Ornish, by the way, does allow a tiny amount of nuts, 3 grams or less. For example, he says 2 cashews or 1 walnut. Though Dr. Ornish does state that the addition of nuts and seeds does not change the Ornish lifestyle medicine, but enhances them to include additional choices. So Dr. Ornish has not seriously altered his well-researched diet or modified his recommendations. And Dr. Esselstyn, of course, has always allowed seeds. Both of these doctors allow nuts and seeds on their regular diets. I'm not protecting anyone's legacy, and I'd like to know specifically from Dr. Furman whom he believes I'm protecting. I do feature Dr. Furman's talks on my DVDs in my store. He has some interesting things to say, so I guess I'm protecting his legacy too. My video series on nuts has nothing to do with protecting anyone's legacy. If anything, it has more to do with protecting consumers from advertising that's disguised as research. So in the opening of his article, Dr. Furman continues, unable to shut down the avalanche of evidence, they attempt to discredit the studies. I wouldn't agree that there is an avalanche of evidence. There is an avalanche of nut industry funded research, but it's weak and easy to discredit. There's an avalanche of bullshit, maybe, but certainly not an avalanche of good evidence. Dr. Furman continues, the facts are extreme low-fat dieters are at higher risk of depression and dementia, as well as premature mortality from all causes, and the evidence increases every year. I have seen no good scientific evidence that vegans consuming a low-fat diet are at higher risk of depression, dementia, or premature mortality because of their healthy dietary choices. But there's plenty of evidence that low-fat vegan dieters do live longer and healthier and better than most people. Dr. Furman's central theme in his article seems to be that number one, that a high nut diet extends your life, and that number two, the low-fat diets of Dr. Esselstyn, Ornish, and maybe he's talking about Pritikin and the other low-fat doctors, that their diets will apparently kill you early. They'll give you dementia. His message seems to be that he, Dr. Furman, is the one doctor who has the true healthy diet, and you should be very frightened if you're not following his diet, and that there's increasing research, according to him, to back up his approach being superior to everyone else's. Okay, well, we know that there's a tremendous amount of research and published evidence on the diets of Dr. Ornish, Dr. Barnard, Dr. Esselstyn, McDougall, Pritikin, Campbell, and the other doctors who've conducted research into a low-fat, plant-based diet. We know that these diet styles dramatically extend life and prevent and reverse many diseases. I guess you might say that the evidence for the low-fat vegan diet is an avalanche, but that would be hyperbole, so I'm not going to do that. Even Dr. Michael Greger, who has fallen into the industry-funded nut trap, talks about how the low-fat vegan diet of Pritikin caused his grandmother Frances, who he says was given a medical death sentence at age 65, it caused her to live another 28 years to age 93. Dr. Greger gives thanks to the diet which gave him more time with his grandmother, the same diet that Dr. Furman claims kills people prematurely. We know Dr. Ornish has numerous studies on his diet published in the top journals of the world. Dr. Barnard has also done a huge amount of very significant dietary research. And of course, the Pritikin program has been going on longer than any of them and has amassed a very significant amount of tight research. Where is the evidence Dr. Furman points to in order to prove that these doctors recommend diets that cause early death or Alzheimer's or depression and so on? Well, from his article, here is the evidence. He writes, we give more credence to studies that involve thousands of participants and go on for decades while looking at hard endpoints like heart attacks and cardiovascular death. All such large studies show the same thing. Nut eating extends lifespan, or to put it another way, the lack of sufficient nuts or seeds in the diet increases premature death, particularly cardiovascular death, as demonstrated in every long-term study examining this issue, such as the Adventist Health Study 1 and 2, the Iowa Woman's Health Study, the Nurses Health Study, the Physician's Health Study. Okay, these are all old, weak association studies from 1992, 1999, 2001, 2002, and the most recent one from 7 years ago in 2012. Some of these studies didn't even track how many nuts the participants ate or how often. So they're weak, speculative, and based on low-quality data. What's surprising is that Dr. Furman is telling his followers that these studies show that nut eating extends life. He claims these studies show that a lack of sufficient nuts and seeds increases premature death. But that's not true. These studies don't say any such thing like that. Nowhere in these studies could Dr. Furman read lines that say nuts extend lifespan or lack of nuts increases premature death, because the researchers in these studies have never said so. I previously discussed in my video how health writers sometimes change the wording and distort the meaning of research, and how they do a serious disservice when they do that. In part one of my video series, I showed articles in medical journals from doctors who are specialists on ethics, and their research shows that it's a big problem and a disservice to the public when people distort the findings of a study. the studies Dr. Furman is pointing to in order to try to discredit Dr. Ornish or Dr. Esselstyn, these are old association studies that are mainly promoted by the nut industry, who paid for most of them, and very few other people are impressed by them. Every one of these studies were done on people, or done by people, who were paid to do scores of nut studies by the nut industry. We all know that with an association study, you might say that nuts are associated with X, but you can't say that nuts caused X. So Dr. Furman is misleading people here. He's exaggerating and misstating what these findings actually say. Anyhow, none of these studies presents any credible evidence that someone eating nuts will live longer, or that someone who avoids nuts is in some kind of danger. This is scaremongering, and Dr. Furman is going to have to come up with actual evidence if he's going to claim that these other doctors like Ornish and Bernard, who do a huge amount of actual research, that they don't know what they're doing. Okay, Dr. Furman continues, "I reviewed the videos as requested by many," meaning some of my videos, "and the main argument to discredit all the epidemiology on the issue was the claim that these studies have been funded by the nut industry, are biased, and therefore should be ignored. But let's be clear, industry funding does not invalidate studies. True, industry is more likely to help fund research if they think it will turn out in their favor. However, these studies must make it through peer review and meet the standards of scientific journals." Dr. Furman is addressing the fact that I've shown that between 80 and 90% of the studies that try to make nuts look good have been paid for by the nut industry. He seems to be implying that since an industry-funded study has to go through peer review and got published in a journal, that we can trust the research and forget about issues around conflicts. But most people disagree. Paying for studies causes bias, and we know from Professor Marion Nestle from NYU, who I've interviewed, she's a leading expert on corruption in nutrition research, that paying for a study practically ensures that the food company will get the result that they want. And they've researched this, they've documented it, it's in many studies, also peer-reviewed. Dr. Bernard at PCRM, he sued the 2015 Dietary Guidelines Advisory Committee after they declared that cholesterol was safe and that eggs were healthy, and they changed the dietary guidelines to reflect that finding. And according to Dr. Bernard's lawsuit, he sued because 90% of the research relied on by the Dietary Committee about eggs were studies that were paid for by the egg industry. And we know that matters. Here, Dr. Bernard cites a meta-analysis on eggs the committee cited where 92% of the studies were paid for by the egg industry. Dr. Bernard also objected to the fact that four of the Dietary Guideline Committee members had themselves been paid to do research for the egg industry. The egg industry paid for nearly all these studies that basically concluded eggs were healthy. According to Dr. Furman's position in his article, Dr. Bernard and the rest of us, I guess, should accept and not question the bias in these egg-funded studies because they went through peer review and they were published in journals. If that's what Dr. Furman believes, then I think he's wrong. Okay, we know that when the dairy industry or the egg industry does not pay for a study, that the research comes out differently. Regarding Dr. Bernard and PCRM, here's a big study from just last month, which was not paid for by the egg industry, that showed eggs and dietary cholesterol are a big health problem. So it contradicts the egg industry-funded studies. And we know the same is true in nuts, that when the nut industry doesn't pay for a study, the nuts don't get the same glowing results at all. They do. So we're going to look at that in a second. So we know the nut industry pays for about 80 to 90% of the research done on nuts, but the real number may very well be even higher than that. Professor Marion Nestle says there's research showing that around 30% of published studies, the investigators, the study authors, did not disclose their conflicts. They didn't disclose that they have a financial relationship or a personal stake in the results.
There have been some studies that suggest that up to 30% of investigators are not fully disclosing. Journals usually make the person who didn't disclose disclose, and they publish a correction on their websites. But people who read the paper generally won't see it.
Now, in truth, Dr. Furman himself is an example of failing to disclose conflicts. Here's a study he did called Fueling the Vegetarian Vegan Athlete. Dr. Furman looked at the question, do vegans need supplements? And in his study, Dr. Furman concluded that yes, they definitely do. They need a bunch of them. Fortunately, Dr. Furman's main business happens to be selling these supplements, so the result of his study just happened to coincide with his personal financial interests. In this section of his study called Suggested Supplements for Vegan Athletes, Dr. Furman lists vitamin D, zinc, DHA, iodine, and taurine as necessary for vegan athletes, according to his research. Now, Dr. Furman did not disclose anywhere in the study that he profits financially from the sale of the supplements, which his study found you need. So this was Dr. Furman's own commercial research for his own interest, just like the nut industry or the egg industry and a lot of businesses that are selling something do. They create research for marketing purposes. The journal which published Dr. Furman's study apparently did later find this out, so they published a correction in a later journal edition. It reads, "Also, a disclosure omission was detected. The lead author, Joel Furman, profits financially from the sale of supplements promoted in the article." Here are two more studies Dr. Furman did, and Dr. Furman's foundation paid for the studies. Both studies recommend a bunch of supplements like iodine, zinc, vitamin D, DHA, and so on, but neither study lists Dr. Furman's conflicts. Now, you can see if you want to freeze this frame that there's research on not disclosing conflicts and other unethical behavior, and they conclude this kind of non-disclosure just represents the tip of an iceberg. And you can see journals all have ethics policies and codes of conduct. This is on Wikipedia, so the issue of funding of conflicts and revealing conflicts is serious, if you care about science and, you know, being accurate. My point here is that while we know that around 80 or 90% of nut studies are paid for by the nut industry or involve researchers who are regularly paid by the nut industry, that's disclosed in the studies, but that number really could even be low, that high number. It doesn't take into account this 30% of research where conflicts have not been disclosed. And it's very important because commercial research is not real science, according to Professor Nessel in my interview and in her book. She talks about this, and marketing research like research on nuts, on eggs, on dairy, Dr. Furman supplement studies, these are designed in a way that is different from real science. And it's important to understand that and to, you know, not be taken in. That's why journals insist that researchers disclose conflicts. Dr. Furman continues in his article about my video saying, "Plus, the studies not at all supported by the nut industry show the same thing. For example, this study funded by the National Cancer Institute included three large cohorts totaling about 200,000 participants followed for 5 to 12 years and concluded that nut intake was associated with a lower risk of total mortality in all three cohorts." This statement of Dr. Furman's isn't actually true either. He cites a study which, yes, was not paid for by the nut industry, and he claims it, quote, "shows the same thing as studies that the nut industry buys, but it does not show the same thing, not at all." I talked about this exact study in part 5 of my video series on nuts. You can go watch that if you want the full details. But the basic point is that the researchers who were not paid by the nut industry, they wrote that they have very low confidence in their findings, that their findings may have nothing to do with nuts. It's true that they found a weak association between nut intake and mortality, but they write in the study that they admit it may have nothing to do with nuts. That's because there were no linear findings. There was no dose response. You would expect if nuts prevented death, that the more nuts you eat, the more protection they would offer. That is what studies which the nut industry pays for finds. But this study, not paid for by the nut industry, did not find that at all. They found that the risk went down a little in the group that had a little bit of nuts, but the more nuts you had, your risk of death didn't go down further. And in fact, in some cases, in some cohorts, it actually went up with more nuts. Under results, the researchers said, "Noteworthy in both the prior report and in our study is the general flatness of the dose response trends. The major difference occurred between individuals with no or little peanut intake and those with some peanut intake, with only minimal decreases in mortality with increasing nut consumption thereafter." In addition, although we have carefully evaluated and adjusted for a wide range of socio-demographic characteristics and lifestyle factors, we cannot completely rule out a residual confounding effect. So that's not at all the same as nut industry-funded studies, as Dr. Furman says. These researchers hedge their weak findings repeatedly, they undercut the association, and they say they can't rule out that something else other than nuts is the cause of what they're seeing here. In the conclusion, they write, "We cannot, however, make etiologic inferences from these observational data, especially with the lack of a clear dose response trend in many of the analyses." So etiologic means causing or contributing to the development of a disease or condition. So they're admitting in their conclusion that for a number of reasons, it's an association study with observational data, the results weren't linear, and there's no dose response. They say they cannot make any inferences about the relationship between nuts and disease and death. So this is a study where they did not find a strong association or any dose response. They may have controlled for more factors than the nut paid researchers do. That's one possible explanation for not getting the same results. The other, and I talk about this in detail in my video that I did about this study, is that the data in this study is completely screwy. The most obese and most unhealthy group ate 2,100 calories a day, while the slimmer, much healthier group ate almost 3,500 calories a day. I go through it in my video, but the data really defies logic. Something is obviously very off about this data, and I'll talk in a moment about how the data in these population studies is actually very low quality to begin with. So now here's another recent well-publicized study of nuts and heart disease. It's a large study. It was from 2018, less than a year ago. It's not 30 years old like the ones Dr. Furman is citing. This study was also not paid for by the nut industry, but for some reason, Dr. Furman doesn't mention this study. And the reason he didn't mention it, I'm guessing, is because it solidly contradicts his assertion that nut studies not funded by the nut industry make the same findings. The researchers found that nuts have almost no effect on heart disease or mortality at all. This was a group of Swedish researchers. They looked at 61,000 individuals for 17 years. So it's another long-term study with hard endpoints, the kind that Dr. Furman relies on and likes. When the researchers controlled for all the variables of the better health of and the better diet of the group who ate the nuts, almost all of the associations between nuts and heart disease disappeared. Here's an article from the New York Times last year. It says, "Nuts may be good for your heart, but are hardly a miracle food." It says, "Nut consumption was associated with lowered risk for heart attack, heart failure, stroke, and the irregular rapid heartbeat called AFib. But people who routinely consume nuts were on average younger and more highly educated, had lower body mass index, were more likely to be physically active, less likely to smoke, and more likely to eat fruits and vegetables. When the researchers controlled for these factors, nut consumption was associated only with a lower risk for AFib and had no significant effect on the other cardiovascular diseases. It's possible that previous studies didn't control for as many factors as we did," said the lead author. "Nuts are a good food, but they may not provide as much benefit as we once thought." So this large Swedish study from 2018 appears to have controlled for more confounding factors than they did back in 1991, 90, and 1999, those other studies. When you do that, the associations seem to disappear. There is no association between nuts and heart disease or longevity because you're factoring in more of the healthy habits of the study group and the overall better diet and lifestyle of the people in the nut eating group. All of that, those associations with nuts go away. Money has a corrupting influence on research. This has been studied extensively and documented. It's been shown repeatedly that it matters very much when an industry pays for research about its own products. People who get paid a lot of money by the nut industry appear to interpret the data around nuts differently from people with no financial stake and no possible agenda. The nut industry got the results that they championed 30 years ago using their hand-picked, highly paid researchers. We know from my interview with Professor Nessel that as a researcher, if you're hired and you do not end up delivering to the food industry the study results that they want, that they won't hire you again. But if you're reliable and you deliver good results for the food company, they will hire you again and again and again, and they'll give you awards, they'll give you gifts. I've shown this graphic many times during my video series. These are the names of a few of the top researchers who have been paid again and again by the nut industry to do studies. These include people who did the research that Dr. Furman is citing in his article. And the top one, Joan Sabate, he teaches at Loma Linda, and I've spent a lot of time talking about him in my series. He's done all the Adventist studies and many, many nut studies. If you do a search on John Sabate and net worth, it brings you to this page, and there's a video of Dr. Sabate talking about the vegetarian diet. It's in Spanish. He's from Spain. And it lists his net worth at $6 million. Now, I don't know if this is even accurate, $6 million net worth. How does someone find out someone else's net worth? His real net worth could be a lot higher. It could be a lot lower. But it certainly wouldn't surprise me if it were $6 million. He's a college professor, although he's never written a best-selling book. That's one way you can earn a lot of money. I'm sure he earns very good money from the nut industry, from the scores and scores of nut studies that he's done and is doing today. And I'm sure the same is true for researchers working again and again for the egg, the dairy, the avocado, the olive oil, the meat industries, and so on. Now, here's Dr. Sabate's bio. You can see he is a member of the Scientific Advisory Board for Paramount Farms. That's a walnut and pistachio business. He's a recipient, Distinguished Service Award for Leadership Nutrition Research. That's from the California Walnut Commission, gave him that award. Study director, the role of almonds on hemostatic inflammatory disease prevention. That's the almond board. Member, Scientific Advisory Board, California Walnut Commission for 17 years. Anyhow, my digression here is to underscore that Dr. Furman is mistaken when he claims that nut research, which is not paid for by the nut industry, gets the same results as the ones the nut industry pays for. Nuts do not look like a superfood when the study is not paid for by the nut industry. Okay, Dr. Furman goes on, when a research institute gets a grant from the nut industry to aid their research, they cannot fabricate the findings that nut-avoiding, fat-phobic vegans were dying younger. Okay, I think Dr. Furman is making a joke because there is actually no study anywhere that nut-avoiding, fat-phobic vegans were dying younger or that low-fat vegans were dying younger. I know he's trying to convince people that such a study exists, but it's nonsense. He's obviously expecting that no one will ask him to back that up. Well, I ask him, Dr. Furman, could you please read a line from the study that states that low-fat vegans die younger? Because there isn't one. Okay, Dr. Furman continues, and the results of the enormous Adventist Health Study 2 were consistent with prior studies and serious, a 39% decreased occurrence of cardiovascular mortality in those eating nuts and seeds at least 5 times a week compared to less than once a week. So sure, the Adventist Health Study 2 found an association between nuts and cardiovascular deaths, but the researchers didn't say that nuts were the cause of the lower heart disease deaths. What would be interesting would be to give the Adventist 2 data to the Swedish researchers in 2018. They control for many more confounders. Give them this old Adventist 2 data and let them make the same adjustments they make in their own studies. I'll bet the associations would disappear. But again, no matter who looks at this data, this is just an association study. If someone in the nut eating group does X, Y, or Z, we know we can't say that it's because of the nuts. It's not caused by the nuts. Only Dr. Furman says that and tries to convince his followers, but it's not true. Okay, Dr. Furman goes on, these studies involve hundreds of researchers, and to claim that they are all in collusion, faking results is not merely biased, but ridiculous, especially when other studies show similar results. Faking results or bias doesn't require hundreds of people in collusion together. That's a straw man argument. If you watch my interview with nutrition expert Marion Nessel, she talks about the various ways that food companies get the results that they want. The key is this, the data does not speak for itself. It has to be interpreted, corrected, adjusted, and that's where researchers make their own decisions about who to exclude, who to include, what inconvenient data to factor out, whether you want to tweak the data in order to make things look better. The egg industry doesn't need 100 collaborators to make a fake research result that eggs are healthy. just one or two people at the top of interpreting the data, usually the ones who are getting paid a lot of money by the industry, they're the ones who make those decisions. Here's a recent settlement concerning research misconduct. It wasn't due to the actions or collusion of hundreds of researchers, just two researchers who falsified data. In his article, Dr. Furman goes on to say, by the way, the increased heart attacks and increased mortality confirmed in the Adventist study has been corroborated in a meta-analysis of 17 carefully vetted studies and every large-scale epidemiological trial, which essentially shows the same thing. Avoidance of nut seeds increases risk of premature death. So we know Dr. Furman is not understanding the research again when he makes claims that studies are showing avoidance of nuts and seeds increase the risk of premature death. No matter how many times Dr. Furman repeats this claim, there is simply no such study to support that. But let's look at this meta-analysis Dr. Furman is referring to. Of course, most of the studies in the meta-analysis were funded by the nut industry, so it's questionable research to start with. But let's look at the conclusion here. It says, nut consumption is associated with lower risk of all-cause CVD and cancer mortality, but the presence of confounding factors should be taken into account when considering such findings. This means the researchers are saying there's an association between nuts and mortality, but that it may not be the nuts which are to be credited for the lower risk of death. So it's a weak study. Researchers advise that we have to take into account that the non-nut factors could be the cause. The researchers are admitting that they were not able to adjust to get rid of all of these confounding factors. They state in the study that they don't have information about the diets or other lifestyle factors of all of the people eating nuts in all of these studies. They say that other factors could be the cause of lower mortality. We're reading on. They said all studies included covariates that may have had significant influence on mortality outcomes such as age, sex when not analyzed separately, BMI, education, physical activity, and smoking status. The researchers say that they had some dietary and lifestyle data on some of the studies, and it seemed like there was an association in those few studies, but it is unclear if the protective effects we observed were mediated by nut consumption or through the clustering of healthy food preferences. Nonetheless, nut consumption may reflect overall healthier lifestyle choices that eventually lead to decreased mortality risk. So Dr. Furman is holding this meta-analysis up, saying that it shows that avoidance of nuts and seeds increases risk of premature death. But of course, when we read it, it found nothing of the sort. The authors concluded that nut consumption may just be a marker for overall healthier lifestyle choices, and that those better choices could well be the reason for lower death in that group and not the nuts. So Dr. Furman is mistaken when he uses this meta-analysis to prove anything here. So continuing, Dr. Furman says, plus multiple other meta-analyses also performed dose response analysis and reported dose response associations between nut intake and a lower risk of all-cause mortality, meaning the more nuts someone ate, the less likely they were to die during the follow-up periods of the studies. Well, we already know that they didn't find any dose response or even any response in the recent large studies that the nut industry didn't pay for. So Dr. Furman cites these three meta-analyses here about dose response. The first one is the meta-analysis that we just looked at, the one I just discussed, the one that found overall healthier lifestyle choices rather than nuts could well be the cause. So that meta-analysis doesn't prove Dr. Furman's point at all. The second meta-analysis he cites, which looked at many of the same industry-funded studies on nuts, it turns out these researchers also declare that nuts may or may not be the reason the nut-eating group is healthier. Subjects with a high intake of nuts tend to be less likely to smoke, to be slimmer and more physically active, to have a lower intake of red and processed meat, and a higher intake of fruits and vegetables than persons with a low nut intake. Thus, confounding by other lifestyle and dietary factors is a potential source of bias. And the researchers go on to write that further future studies need to adjust for more dietary confounders, like the Swedish people researchers do. They acknowledge that it's awfully hard to try to isolate out just one food from everything in a person's diet and lifestyle, and to try to pin the blame or the credit on just that one food. If you watch my interview with Professor Nessel, you know that she completely discredits these studies of one food, that these are almost always marketing driven, and that there's no way to make reliable conclusions about single foods unless you totally control for all the other, you know, issues ahead of time, which is nearly impossible to do. Maybe if you were running a long study in a prison where they can control a lot of things, but it's just impossible. So the researchers are doing a meta-analysis. Well, what about looking at things like the amount of saturated fat these people are eating? Nut eaters consume a lot less saturated fat than people who don't eat nuts. What about salt intake? What about beans? And so on. Why only look at nuts when there's other foods that could be as much or more significant for health? And the answer seems to be that he who pays the piper calls the tune, as the saying goes. And the nut industry is paying, they're going to decide what the study is going to look at. So the researchers in the second meta-analysis that Dr. Furman cites, they even comment on the discredited PREDIMED study. And this is the study that was paid for by two nut companies and two olive oil companies. And the researchers note an association between nut intake and lower stroke deaths in PREDIMED. But then they go on to say, however, it is not clear if this association is due to the Mediterranean diet component, nuts, or a combination of the two. So you can see in the second meta-analysis Dr. Furman is pointing to, it's not some strong cut and dried study in favor of nuts. Just like the first one, the researchers aren't even sure if nuts are causing any of the benefits that they're observing. The third meta-analysis Dr. Furman cites in this passage is this one, and we can read from it here. Nut consumers were on average somewhat younger, leaner, and women, drank more alcohol, ate more vegetables and fruits, were less often hypertensive or never smokers, women, but were higher educated and more often used supplements or postmenopausal hormone replacement therapy. Women with the highest nut consumption less often reported diabetes. So we see the same thing in this third meta-analysis as we did the first two. They can't account for and adjust all the dietary patterns and other health differences in these groups. The important point is that Dr. Furman is violating the basic principle of association studies with all of this research that he's citing, and that is that it's interesting to see associations and to see possible relationships and hints of things to look into further, but they can't and they don't actually prove anything. As the researchers themselves remind us repeatedly in the studies that Dr. Furman is relying on, and then that Dr. Furman is overstating. Okay, Dr. Furman's next statement is, the next claim made was that all these epidemiology studies are wrong because those eating more nuts were healthier overall for other reasons, such as they ate more vegetables, ate less meat, were less likely to be overweight and exercised more. This was evaluated in the study, and the researchers used modern statistical methods to control and evaluate for confounding factors. Well, actually, there is no universally accepted way, a proven formula that all researchers agree on and use in every study and every situation that, you know, magically evaluates and controls for all known and unknown confounding factors. That's why population studies are not really reliable. They're guesswork, they're judgment calls, and every researcher can do it a little bit differently than everybody else. I'm going to put a link in the description to a very recent article from the Washington Post. It's by a columnist who regularly writes about nutrition issues, and it's titled, Here's What the Government's Dietary Guidelines Should Really Say. And the article talks about these exact problems with nutrition research, and the author quotes some leading experts in the article. She says, the reason we know so little about what to eat despite decades of research is that our tools are woefully inadequate. Lately, as scientists try and fail to reproduce results, all of science is taking a hard look at funding biases, statistical shenanigans, and groupthink. All that criticism, and then some, applies to nutrition. I could spend a lot of time talking about this article. It's really good. Go and read it if you're interested. Basically, it spotlights these food frequency questionnaires that are used in these population studies to gather the food data, and they are really flawed. There are studies that show they're definitely wrong 2/3 of the time. And they quote a Stanford professor, and they quote one of the main nut researchers, Dr. Frank Hu from Harvard, who both agree that studies of dietary patterns are the only useful kinds of research for, you know, figuring out nutrition and health. Now, that's a huge admission from this guy, Dr. Frank Hu, who did many of the nut studies and other studies of just one food for a variety of different food companies. He's, you know, biting the hand that feeds him, basically. He's cutting the legs out from under Dr. Furman by admitting that the studies he's done for the nut and other industries, they aren't really that useful for help. They're useful for companies trying to market products, maybe, but not. It's not the kind of research that he wants to do in order to learn the important information about diet and health. Go read the article. Both these top nutrition researchers are saying the same thing. There's no superfoods. So going back to Dr. Furman's article, he writes, "Then it was falsely claimed the reduction in cholesterol by eating nuts is small and is just due to displacing meat and dairy. The Adventist Health Study refutes that, showing cumulative effects from the combination of several health behaviors in vegetarian participants who exercised regularly. Expected age of death was 7.8 years older in the group who ate nuts regularly versus those who did not." Okay, that's a little confusing and potentially misleading. He's trying to make it sound like nuts add 7 years. That's not what this researcher wrote. This is a paper that was written by Dr. Gary Fraser. He is one of the very highly paid nut industry researchers who I've discussed in previous videos. And he's also one of the people that runs the Loma Linda Adventist study. So this is an old association study. This article is almost 20 years old. It was written by Dr. Fraser in 2001. And here's what he said in his paper about longevity. "California Adventists have higher life expectancies at the age of 30 years than other white Californians by 7.28 years in men and by 4.42 years in women." So now here is his only comment in the paper about nuts and life expectancy. "High physical activity, frequent consumption of nuts, vegetarian status, and medium body mass index each result in an approximate 1.5 to 2.5 years gain in life expectancy compared with the corresponding high-risk values." So according to this old article Dr. Furman is bringing up, nut eating may increase your life by 1.5 to 2.5 years gain in life expectancy, and that it assumes that you're doing the other things in this paragraph, lots of exercise, you're vegetarian, you have a low BMI, then that's only work as part of several factors working together, according to Dr. Fraser in his article here. So eating nuts might be associated with 1.5 to 2.5 years extra lifespan, according to his speculation here. But Dr. Fraser is careful to say that it is not caused by the nuts. Eating nuts, he says, is considered one of the preventive activities in his article, and he says there is little direct evidence that life is extended by preventive strategies. And he talks about how hard it is to estimate and speculate how much extra life you might or might not get from a particular preventive strategy. He says, "The implication that this is so has been strong, as many of these strategies are associated with lower relative risk of mortality, and in many cases these associations are reasonably assumed to be causal. Unfortunately, the mathematical relationship between a lower relative risk and extra years of life is complex. It is not easy to predict the number of years of life gained from a particular reduction in a relative risk for all-cause mortality." We have larger studies that are more recent research running for a longer time available, and that we put more credence in, like the Swedish study from last year, not paid for by the nut industry, that showed no association between nuts and longevity when you adjust for the confounders that Dr. Fraser probably didn't adjust for back in the 1990s. But Dr. Fraser didn't make any estimates in his article for how many extra days, months, or years you get from beans or you get from sweet potatoes or other foods. He doesn't work for those companies. To underscore sort of the silliness of this approach, here's an article. "Your life expectancy can vary depending on where you live. Here are the U.S. cities where residents live the longest." And it shows people live 7 or 8 years longer on average in Salt Lake City, Utah, than in Newark, New Jersey. Now, if you move from Newark to Salt Lake City, no matter what part of Salt Lake City, if you're in a slum, you're in a homeless shelter, can we say you will live 7 or 8 years longer? Well, this is an association study, you know, between City A and City B. But can you make a blanket statement that moving from this city to that city will add 7 or 8 years to your life? Well, no one's actually done a study on that. There's no evidence to back that up. And the same is true for the data that Dr. Furman uses to claim that nuts make you live longer or prevent heart attacks. There's no actual evidence backing up Dr. Furman's speculations. Okay, Dr. Furman continues, "They claim there are no studies on vegans with heart disease using nuts, conveniently avoiding my paper published in the American Journal of Lifestyle Medicine documenting impressive cardiovascular results while including nuts and seeds and reporting more dramatic sustained weight loss." Okay, I have already talked about this study by Dr. Furman. I did a whole video on it You can watch the video if you want to know what I think, but I'm afraid I don't believe this study is impressive at all. It's not really a study because Dr. Furman gathered data using an anonymous online questionnaire to get answers from anonymous people, and then he published it as data. Anyone could do that. I don't really consider that a study. It also featured some case studies, including one woman who appeared to cure her heart disease with a high nut diet, only to then die young before the study was even published. It's unfortunate, but that's what happened with this study of Dr. Furman's. I could show case studies done on the keto diet that have similar effects as Dr. Furman's case study. So I don't find that very impressive. Dr. Furman continues, to assume the safety of radically excluding fats with heart patients would require a larger population and a longer follow-up period, like the epidemiology studies mentioned above that all showed excluding nuts and seeds to be dangerous. Again, Dr. Furman is misstating the research and making up claims about these association studies. There are no association studies or any studies that show excluding nuts and seeds is dangerous. Dr. Furman's repetition reminds me of that quote, if you tell a lie big enough and long enough and keep repeating it, some people will eventually come to believe it. All right, he continues, the other issue is that I have 30 years of clinical experience caring for this community of damaged vegans who can and do develop anxiety, severe depression, postpartum depression, and dementia as a result of such irresponsible advice to ignore the need for fatty acid adequacy, including DHA, promoted by this community. Oh, well, my view of that is everyone's welcome to their anecdotal stories. I do know that one of the top research outfits, the most respected organization with recognized scientific integrity who doesn't accept money from corporations, is called the Cochrane Review. And I know that when they looked at the highest quality randomized controlled trials around nuts and heart disease, they found the following. Currently, there is a lack of evidence for the effects of nut consumption on cardiovascular disease, clinical events, in primary prevention, and very limited evidence for the effects on CVD risk factors. No conclusions can be drawn, and further high-quality, longer-term, and adequately powered trials are needed to answer the review question. They found a lack of evidence when looking at randomized controlled trials of nuts and heart disease. And this really brings it home. You can play with association studies until the cows come home. It doesn't get you very far. When they do the randomized controlled trials, the real evidence, that's where Dr. Furman has a problem in order to back up his beliefs, because it's not there. There's no research. They've tried and they can't find it. So it doesn't work with everyone simply to repeat again and again that nuts will do this when there's not solid evidence to back that up. Is Dr. Furman going to respond to this video today by listing another 20 or 30 weak industry-funded association studies and, you know, try to keep promoting nuts that way? If so, that would just confirm to me that he's got no good data, or he can't, you know, properly analyze the data. Or that you just can't simply address the concerns that I've raised in my video series. And I can say that several leading plant-based researchers and experts in the field have told me privately that they agree with me on this issue of the nut research. So I don't plan to waste too much more time debating low-quality association studies that can't even show cause and effect in the first place. It's pretty obvious that if what Dr. Furman were saying about nuts were true, and if the case were really so solid as he contends, why wouldn't the nut industry make those claims in advertisements? Why wouldn't the nut industry go to the FDA and get permission to make an official health claim that nuts can extend your life 1 to 2 years, you know, using this 2001 paper from Dr. Fraser that Dr. Furman is relying on? If what Dr. Furman says about nuts were true, don't you think that the nut industry would be saying the same things? But looking at Dr. Furman's response that he wrote to my on this series, he makes these sweeping statements that the evidence is overwhelming, an avalanche of evidence, there's new evidence coming in every day, and then he quotes a bunch of old, weak studies from the 1990s, primarily, to back this up. So just repeating things that aren't really true, but just by sheer repetition and, you know, force of expressing it, maybe some people get taken in. I'm going to do a video soon on omega-3 and DHA, because this is another big issue that I see a lot of vegans getting frightened about. people get concerned by something they read or they hear, and it's based on very poor evidence. So that's on my to-do list. That is today's video. Thank you for watching. Please post your comments or questions. I'll try to answer them down below. I am posting the links in the description to what I mentioned in the video. Thank you for tuning in. If you found this interesting, please give it a like. Please subscribe. I'll see you on the next one. Thanks.